6 o'clock.
Why don't we?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Pull this forward, Danielle. I'm told that I'm very soft.
Right there. As opposed to me, the mic should be on the other side of the room.
Yeah, we'll turn it this way for you. Okay, so the first thing is the approval of minutes from February 9th, 2016. Any questions on the minutes?
No.
Okay.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, they're approved. Financial report.
Okay, dealing with just current year right now.
Yep.
In your packet is the most recent financial report, which I do not believe has changed significantly since last month. We're plugging along at a steady level, and fortunately nothing significant has happened in the last month as far as your facility or any unexpected changes. So we're cruising along here, clearly going to be spending some of our school choice appropriation by year end, and as we get closer to the year, we'll see how much.
Okay. Any questions on the financial report? Okay. PTO report. Do we have anything for PTO tonight? Okay. Public access one. Okay. Communications.
I did you have any? I'm not sure.
Do we have a second reading, or that's the it's
unfinished
and that's
business. On the yeah. Further down is the calendar and the second reading. So as far as just general FYI, I don't think there was anything other than items that we'll talk about during the superintendent's report.
Okay. Sounds good. Principal's report.
Okay, just a couple of things. I want to target both literacy night and math night. And as you can see in there, the names of those who were instrumental in that. Thank you, Mrs. Parker, who happens to be here, for a fabulous math night. And then Mrs. Tarr for organizing the literacy night. They were both wonderful events, lots of staff members working to make sure that the word got out. The turnout was wonderful this year for both events, and the feedback I got from parents was just remarkable. It's led us to now contemplate, which we'll be talking about, we're actually going to do a Paul Pride Night March 31st, which is the extension of PBIS. So now we have our academic components, and now we're going to be doing a night around Paw Pride, targeting behaviors that help students go beyond just bullying to why we want to care about each other and why it's something you can be proud about as a Tiger. So that will be coming up the 31st. And I have parents, this is the most exciting part of all, who are helping me put this on and are doing the activities. And it's a parent of a student in kindergarten who came to me to talk about it, who's in her school psychology degree and wants to use it for her degree. I'm like, we can sit down and plan this.
Win-win.
We can do, yes, win-win-win. So I'm so excited about it.
You Very said that's the 31st?
It'll be the 31st, the night of the 31st of March, yes. So more will be coming on that. Also, Community Reading Day, thanks to the superintendent, assistant superintendent. We had so many wonderful people here. Our dog officer for the town came and read Balto to the students. Mm-hmm. She's a musher. Her children are mushers. And that story is about a mush dog who saved the lives of a couple of kids in Alaska back in the 1912, I think it was, 12 or 13. So she came and read that. So the kids were so engaged in everything that happened on Community Reading Day. Awesome event. Very thankful that we had that. Those were really the things I wanted to target. If there's any other questions about the report, happy to answer them. February isn't a big month for crazy activity, so.
Just want to reiterate that the math night and the literacy night were just phenomenal. Just phenomenal. I've never seen a math musical you guys did right at the beginning when we walked in.
That was
incredible. So it was a great job by everybody involved.
And I did want to thank you, the two of you that were able to come. I know it was during a school day for our science lab naming ceremony. Very difficult time of day, 3:30 in the afternoon. So thank you for coming and supporting that. I know it was very meaningful. Some wonderful articles in the newspaper highlighting the life of Sue, and it was just beautiful. I'm so thankful that you guys supported that.
That was great. Okay, thank you. Superintendent's report.
Okay, I am pinch hitting. There's a few things on here. Okay, the first is somewhat FYI, but warranted at least bringing up that your educator performance data is out there, which is awesome. And pretty much what we would expect, that 94%, nearly all of your educators are ranked at proficient, which is the goal. It's a pretty rigorous evaluator process, so that's awesome, and that's out there. And you've got 5.9% under needs improvement and being worked with the principal, and I'm sure will be to great success with a school this size. I think that's probably two folks.
That's what we've figured out.
It doesn't take long. So that's there mostly as your FYI.
Yep.
The next item is the what we hope is the final school calendar. You've got the draft there. It is the only difference between what you all voted as a full group back in November is we've finally come up with the recommended PD days, early releases. So if there are no questions or concerns, we would ask that you vote to accept this calendar as the 2016-17 school calendar.
May 29th is the last day of school.
No. May 29th is a holiday.
Fair enough.
If
that's
there were
birthday
no
weekend,
snow
Brian.
Days.
Oh, why isn't that even, it's not even denoted.
Don't
here.
We wish.
It doesn't even say your birthday.
We have to add that to the calendar.
If there were no snow days, the last day would be the 14th of June.
Oh, okay, there it is.
You've got your 180 required days, unfortunately.
There it is.
So, which leaves plenty of time for a few snow days and to still meet your legal obligation of 180 by June 30th.
Sure. Okay.
So we're going to shoot for the 14th of June. Wouldn't that be a good year?
And all of the unnecessary bold font is gone now, so.
Right. We're pretty, and with the whole color code, it's really about those PD days, mm-hmm. which ultimately would, we would mass distribute without the colors, but usually that's just the kind of dotted line around there.
Okay. So I'll make a motion to accept the calendar, the draft as is.
Actually, you'd be making it official.
Okay, yep. Making it official that we support the union's overall calendar, right? Because this is not a Brookfield. This is
correct.
A union calendar.
This will be district-wide, and I believe this is the third or fourth school committee that would vote
support
to accept it.
Good.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Set
awesome.
Do we need to put that in?
Thank you.
Next
on the agenda would be typically at this time of year, our policy actually for school choice has us taking school choice applications for next year until March 31st and pulling the lottery for any slots that we do have open. It reads the first Monday in April, so I think I said that was the fourth. With the exception of kindergarten, we do wait until June to decide or make recommendations on how many slots there are because we need as much time as possible to find out for sure what we've got for Brookfield residents, and that is not simply a factor of how many are sitting in pre-K.
Yeah.
So that being said, and if you don't, for those who are new this far into the process, If a school committee does not take a vote at all regarding school choice, they are deemed a school choice district. The default is you are school choice. So some of the schools in our district choose not to, and they need to take the vote to not be. Even so, if you don't take some kind of vote on your limitations or how many slots or what your classroom expectation is, you'd be kind of just full-blown school choice. So you do take a vote every year at the principal's recommendation as to how many new. Once they're in, they stay in. So our recommendation here really is to how many additional school choice slots that we would have or be open to when we pull that lottery the first week of April. So
and that's
you,
how many for grades 1 through 6.
Correct.
It's not kindergarten.
Correct.
We're going to hold off and make those slots, but this is one. This is grades 1 through 6.
Correct.
Right.
How many new slots we want to add in there.
Right. I don't think there's a whole lot.
Question, I guess, real quick. Mm-hmm. Would it be 6th grade kids as well that we'd be considering for this?
Well, it has
typical?
Been our recommendation for the last couple of years to not take new folks in 5th and 6th grade. Primarily because Tantasqua has kind of a general agreement and understanding that anybody who comes from any of the 5 elementary schools as school choice would have first dibs into their 7th grade slots. So all committees are pretty much working together to make sure there's not this huge influx at the elementary level pushing in at 6th grade and then forcing Tantasqua to take all of those in 7th grade because they don't necessarily want to open up that many slots.
And we already send them.
We do it.
Yes.
Put them out. Exactly.
Yeah.
So, which is awesome. So typically our recommendations are tonight anyway are for grades 1 through 4.
Right.
New slots in next
right.
year's 1 through 4.
Right.
Okay.
And even if we had thought we wanted to take for 5th and 6th grade, we have no slots. So, and we have no slots anywhere other than next year we'll have slots for 3rd grade and 4th grade. 3rd grade, my recommendation would be to take up to, that's just the computer on the library going to sleep. So, yes, we're all well, all is well. So, 3rd grade for next year, I recommend we could take up to 4 slots. There are 36 current students in grade 2. I actually only have one school choice application for that grade level. And then 4th grade for next year. This year's 3rd grade moving to 4th, I have 37 students, so I would recommend up to 3 slots. Right now I only have one school choice application, but there's a sibling application, which means that that student probably is not going to come because there's no slot for the sibling. So typically a parent won't split their children between two schools. We would offer it if they wanted to. At this point, there's not even the need for a lottery, although you have to pull the number anyway. You know, your number is 1, and I can take up to 3, so 1, wow, you got in. So you do it just because it's the process, but the one student would get in based on that recommendation. There are no slots for grades 1 of next year, grades 2, grades 5, or grade 6. They're all maxed out. If we continue to use our number of 20 or more students, we will only take Brookfield students in those grade levels or classrooms.
Yeah. And sir, how many did you say we have for the group going from second to third? How many applications?
Second to third, we currently have 36 students.
How many applications you said there were out there with?
Just one.
Just one, okay.
And you said up to how many slots?
Four more. Four.
Up
the recommendation
to four.
Is up to 4 more third graders and up to 3 more
fourth
graders.
Correct.
Yep.
And they can apply until the end of March,
they
so
can.
A couple could.
Yeah, it's possible
one
we'll get another one or two or three. Who knows? But
now, if you saw, because this seems to fluctuate a decent amount, over a couple months.
Yeah.
If you see some people go out, would you come back and say, okay, how do I say this? Because we have a vote right now. We can vote in a certain amount. Can we give you permission over the next couple months? Let's say it drops.
Yes.
You know, 2 or 3. A couple siblings leave. And it drops us below that you have over the next couple months.
Yeah.
Right, because what I can tell you is I have 2 applications for first grade for next year.
Okay.
I have 2 applications for second grade for next year. So
your global way, actually, and perhaps this is a better way to take the vote, is that your vote be to allow school choice students, in fact, you could even say, to allow new school choice students grades 1 through 4 for class sizes of up to 20. So then if a slot opens up, she could automatically
Someone comes along.
To fill
that's right.
It.
At your discretion.
Yep.
Up to that 20.
Yep.
So you don't have to come back to us.
And that is
what
happens up at Tantasqua. So that's probably a better way to put it.
I think
and
that
then
is
we'll
good.
Talk about kindergarten afterwards.
Okay.
Okay.
So I'd make a motion to accept school choice applications up to 20 per class going to 2017. So at the principal's discretion that they can make
for grades
changes.
1 to 4.
Grades 1 to 4 if students leave.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Got it.
Awesome. Then just a couple of little pieces. The building use update is simply just, if you recall, we had said that we kind of relook at the policy and the process over the summer, and we just wanted, in an effort to be completely clear, we had reported last month that there were other schools in the district that did use the building, their buildings, during school vacations, and we just found out and wanted to clarify that all of that use is only during the day. So when we're looking at what we might want to do, it what did make a difference is during school vacations, it was daytime use, not evening use. And as I had referred, sometimes your custodial staff all moves to the day shift for project work, et cetera. So we did confirm with the other schools that there's no nighttime use of the community use during. So that's just something to know about and for us to consider when we're looking at things over the summer for next fall's use.
And I guess maybe just to add, what about over the summertime itself? Just curious. I know it's outside of this.
Yeah, absolutely can't. And if you've ever been in here in the summer, you'd know why, because the hallways are filled with equipment, with desks, with everything gets pulled out of every classroom, stored in hallways. It's a danger zone.
And I'm not aware, other than perhaps probably Tantasco in the field house, I'm not aware of other schools even having the request for community use or practices, and if so, it let me know.
Well, I know that we got approached as on the rec committee side of it.
Yeah, there is so much. I mean, that's heavy duty project work. Anything that's being done in this building, project wise, new flooring, moving, and even if it's not new projects, and it's every classroom gets gutted and everything gets moved out to give it the real scrubbing. Mm-hmm. So that would be even more challenging. Mm-hmm. To try and accommodate, plus, we are less staffed in general sometimes, and there's vacations sometimes going on with the custodial staff. So my suggestion would be that we not start that practice. I mean, obviously, if there's some individual special stuff, we've probably maybe had,
Memorial,
special festival.
Yeah,
Memorial Day's
school.
Not.
That's still during
But that's
school.
What I was thinking of. It's like I know there's an old home day down in Wales, and there's probably part of that day celebration that has something to do with the school, but not as a general ongoing.
Okay. What about the request that came to us originally was, one of them came was around December in the holiday break that happens at that
point. Right, and that's what we need to relook at the policy and figure out what we can or could reasonably accommodate with that schedule. Because I think in the past we've done absolutely none.
Okay.
On the Christmas break and the February and the April.
Yep.
And there are one or two other elementary schools that apparently are allowing some use practices. Probably basketball season is the primary.
Yeah.
So we can take a look at that.
Sure. Okay. So if we can, if we'd like to take a look at that, and then we can get back to the rec committee as they plan next year.
Yep.
How we do that.
Yep.
So let's keep that on here and see what we can.
Awesome.
This month.
And then the last little bit, which isn't listed here, is just a reminder if anyone is planning to attend the annual Day on the Hill up at the State House, that the early registration incentive is for this Friday. After that, it's, I think, $15 more. And your budget pays for the registration. But in general, if you have any interest, you've probably received the flyers. And Deb Grimaldi would be happy to make your reservations if anybody wants to attend. That'll be it.
Okay, thank you. That's great.
Yeah, okay.
That's my highlights here. Look at this.
I'll try to read quickly. Okay. For the financial report, the committee voted to approve a proposed fiscal year 17 budget of 21,992,245, which is up 4.23% from fiscal year 16. The greater increase coming from out-of-district tuitions, which was 210,000, which is up 110%. For staff reports, this line shouldn't be here. Mr. Starczewski, junior high principal, highlighted Spirit Week theme days. Food services manager Mrs. Banal and health educator Mrs. Canavan collaborated on a smoothie recipe contest won by eighth grader Bella Barubi. The program was awarded a grant to purchase a smoothie equipment for the lunch line.
Nice.
The junior high Winter Olympics were held on February 12th and included a student faculty floor hockey tournament. There was a Valentine's Day student council candygram sale, and some examples of learning activities observed by the principal include utilizing rubrics and writing examples to assess student understanding of quality writing, preparing and presenting impassioned speeches on historical topics, project-based learning, generating 3D and topographic representations of geographic regions, and writing to defend perspective on a challenging topic. There was also a book club as a spinoff of SSR, Sustained Silent Reading Time. From Mr. Lucas, high school principal, he highlighted CPR certification for PE and health classes on April 29th. There was a spotlight on the math department. Student council had their New Year dance. They handed out mints and cocoa for all students taking final exams. They completed their book of excellence and submitted it to the Mass Association for Student Councils for judging. For performing arts, we had 5 students accepted into the MMEA band, orchestra, or chorus. They will be performing at Symphony Hall on Saturday, March 12th. I guess that just passed. The show choir participated in the Central Mass Show Choir Festival. Encore won a silver medal. And the Nutmeg Show Choir Festival was at the end of February. Tantasqua and Union 61 All-Region Band performed at Tantasqua on March 1st. For sports, the boys track had a perfect season. They went 14-0 and won the SWCL Track Championship. And there was an impressive performance by boys and girls swimming, boys and girls basketball, and hockey.
And your basketball team is Western yes. D2 champ and starting in about a half an hour, hopefully beating the Central champs at DCU Central.
That's where all the action is tonight.
Yeah.
For Mr. Wood, technical principal, for guidance, they're meeting with sophomores to complete career planning, preparing transcripts, reports, and recommendations for senior tech students, freshman exploratory curriculum. I won't go through all of them, but students are exploring each of 7 programs for 1 week. Skills USA, they prepare for a district competition on March 9th, and any students who take gold or silver move on to states in April. For culinary, the students prepared a luncheon for the TED grant writing workshop, and they were a winner of Worcester's Best Chef competition at Mechanics Hall, winning a $3,500 prize.
Wow, great.
And they're preparing for the 5th annual Team Chef competition at the Sturbridge Host. Mm-hmm. For electrical, junior-senior projects include Brimfield Town Hall and Library, Wales Elementary, Sturbridge Fire, Tantasqua Regional High School, Village Campground, Village Green Campground, and some residential properties. Health career seniors are attending clinical internships at the Meadows and Harrington Hospital. Students accepted into Becker College and Curry College nursing programs, and there was one student accepted into the Sacred Heart University's doctoral program in physical therapy, which is highly competitive. For business, there is a business plan for Milestone Learning Center as an example of real-life application of skills and collaboration with other programs. Carpentry, Sturbridge Conservation Signage, and Sturbridge Safety Complex, CAD Mechanical Design, competing at Extreme Redesign 3D Printing Challenge New England Regional Semifinals, and attending an all-day STEM conference at WPI on March 6th. For IT, the seniors sat for the National Network Administration Certification Exam. And for cooperative education, placements at Dyens Corporation, Arlen Tools, and R&L Construction. Subcommittee reports. For the technical division, the technical school is receiving a $100,000 grant from the state to purchase a high-performance turning center. Coordinated program review, the initial feedback was highly complimentary. There were a few minor safety issues identified, and all but 2 have been corrected, and those 2 are in progress. For the program advisory, the recommendations include new mannequins and AEDs for health careers, a rotary hammer drill for electrical, a 20-quart mixer for culinary, and increased serve-safe opportunities. For admissions, that's in progress, and there was an information night in January that was well attended. And curriculum, we discussed budget implications, the senior internship program, and then we read and discussed a book by Frank Bruni called Where You Go Is Not Who You'll Be, An Anecdote to College Admissions Mania, which was incredibly interesting. And then the turf project is not going to proceed with Crumb Rubber Infield. We're going with Gale Associates of Weymouth for design engineering, and the turf committee consists of the building principal, the AD, and three school committee members.
Sounds good.
That's it.
Great, well, thank you.
Questions?
Okay. Unfinished business. So this is the second reading of the physical restraint of students policy. Read through it again.
We just had that initial reading last month, so it's just the second reading and adoption.
So we're voting for adoption. Did anyone have any changes or any thoughts to it?
Nope.
Okay.
Motion to adopt.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. New business. Didn't have anything here.
I have nothing else.
No. Okay. Okay. Public access, number two. Anything? Yes.
Since I wasn't here for the last meeting, could you give me an overview of the student restraint policy?
We can, if you want to read it, I can give it to you right now.
The changes are just the legal law, putting the legal changes in language and are exactly what, when we had our coordinated program review, they saw that as meeting all the standards that we're supposed to, but it's really the new legal language. So, do you have any details in there?
Okay. Anything else for public access? Okay, moving on. Since we have 2 minutes before we can
recess.
Yeah, let's recess.
Call a recess and public.
Recess at this point and
public hearing
come
at
back
6:30.
In 2 minutes at 6:30.
Alrighty. Awesome.
Okay, so why don't we move into the public session here.
Alrighty.
So do you want to kick this?
Yeah, I'll kick it off and go through the pretty picture section and then start going into the drier number section. So.
I like the pretty picture section.
I know, exactly. So we're sitting here to review the proposed fiscal 17 budget. By the end of the public hearing, answering any questions there might be, we'll go back into regular session, and the school committee's obligation at that point is to vote the bottom line dollar that they are comfortable formally submitting to the town to go to town warrant for your town meeting vote on next year's budget. I think things are actually going pretty well this year and looking that way for next year. The overall budget request that we're going to go through right now is an increase of just 1.4%, which is, I think, pretty good and respectable. The picture part here just goes through just some basic snapshots of what's happening or summary of what's going on in this budget. And hopefully, does everyone have the little pictures? Okay, great. The first page is just a picture of the basic standard sections that the state breaks out its reporting when they ask for various things. Some folks recall it's called by series, the 1000 series, 2000 series, and it breaks out that piece of the pie. So 1000 series is administrative and school committee expenses. 2000 series is anything instruction, direct instruction, which, as it should be, is the biggest, humongous piece of the pie, and it should be. Ancillary services are, for an elementary school, are pretty much your transportation and your health services, your nursing. When you get up to the secondary, that'd be where your athletics and your extracurricular things are. Building operations is exactly as it says, your custodial, your maintenance, your general maintaining of the building. Replacement and acquisition of equipment is teeny tiny here because we have the fortunate situation and luxury of being able to fund most of your equipment and capital items through your school choice dollars, and that's been done for a number of years, and that again is the intention here. So we're keeping the building up with projects, but they're not in this budget. And then out of district tuitions are any special ed or vocational tuitions for programs that Tantascwa does not offer, and that sliver of the pie is actually pretty small. Which is great. It just leaves you in a position of hopefully nothing changes, but that's where things can spike. The second page is a breakout of just salaries. So As you would expect, we are in a service organ. We are in a service company. Our product is delivering service, not something, you know, hard, substantial. Almost all of this budget is salaries. 80% of the budget is salaries, and all of them actually have contractual obligations. So of that 80%, again, the pie shows you where those salaries are going, with the bigger piece going directly to instruction, guidance being a support to that instruction, same thing with your nursing, and then your building administration and custodial support, showing the small pieces, which really is exactly as a nice educational pie should look. The next page just starts showing a little bit of history on both the budget and the student enrollment. So the budget here really has pretty regularly been kept pretty low and even below level, which I think is pretty impressive. And there was that one spike back in fiscal 13, which I am sure I recall being related to some very hefty out of district special ed tuitions. And then, you know, fortunately, following, you know, we were able to bring it right back down. So we've kept things pretty low over the past 6 to 7 years, while enrollment has overall for the building kind of peaked up, dropped down a couple of years ago, mm-hmm. but is back on, you know, took another big chunk back up and then seems to be level. So the fact that the enrollment in general in the building is holding level next year has helped us come in with a budget pretty low. We did then on the next page take out that building enrollment and break it out by Brookfield only versus school choice. So the last couple of years, your school choice enrollment has held steady. Brookfield, as we all just referred to, had taken a dip 3 or 4 years ago and then has climbed back up. Looks right now like that we had a pretty significant bump from fiscal 15 to 16. Mm-hmm. But 16 to 17 looks like it's going to hold steady, which again allowed us to kind of keep everything in place in the building and hopefully keep levels of services level. The last page, actually this last page often is something that I'm sitting here saying, what's the drivers for the increases? But there aren't any major increases or issues in this budget. Again, level enrollment, special needs, as we'll get to shortly, the out-of-district placements is decreasing significantly, either due to a student aging out or changing the placement, sometimes bringing back to in-house services. But that decrease has helped drive everything else in the budget, because we do have contractual salary obligations and we do have basic needs and supplies that we need to keep up. But the decrease in the tuitions helped keep the overall budget down pretty low. And again, as I mentioned, we continue to fund technology and facility projects, capital projects from school choice. So that's the picture portion of the evening. If you then go to the number document, the first two pages are pretty much what I just talked about in number form, showing the overall summary of what we're going to present to you and the various different ups and downs of the sections. So what we'd like to do is move on to what is labeled as the second page one. So it's the first landscape form. It'll be the third page in. And what Kathleen and I will do here is go page by page and chat about something that anything that looks like there's a spike up or down and folks might be wondering what's going on, we will try to speak to. And before we move to the next page, we'll just see if there are any other questions on that page. Alrighty. First on that page is a typo. The legal services and the school committee dues and convention, it actually both should be switched. But actually, the legal notices, as you can see, we've been able to decrease what we're spending on legal notices. We're now allowed to put things online and to post on web. So really the expectation is to just try and look for the $500 that we spent last year for those legal notices and postings. However, the increase, we are having increased participation and increased school committee dues for Mass Association of School Committee is increasing their dues next year, and participation at the conferences for school committee members has A, increased a little bit in cost, and B, there we appear to have more attendance. So we did want to switch that and keep the overall dollars level, but where those dollars will be spent should be different than it has in the last few years. Everything else on that page is Brookfield Elementary's share of the central office budget. The budget as a whole was voted back in November when all 34 school committee members come together and look at the entire budget and voted. And then this here is just the elementary school's piece of the pie. So the piece of the pie actually for Brookfield Elementary is nearly identical next year. Fiscal 16 currently is 8.74% of the total cost of central office, and that's strictly based on enrollment, district-wide total enrollment, where the kids are, and that's where we divide the central office by. And then fiscal 17 is 8.71%, so pretty much the exact same share, and this is just that the total budget broken out. Any other questions on that page? Okay, page two, I did want to mention, because right off the bat you look at, for example, the administrative assistant line, which looks level. We do have one of our two bargaining units negotiating this year, the educational support staff, which is pretty much everyone but the teachers, are all in that unit and are negotiating. So when we have negotiations going on, we tend to put a pool of dollars for negotiations on one line item. And then when we finish and settle, we will transfer out to into each individual. So you'll see line items such as that admin assistant, or later on perhaps custodial, or some of the other support areas that looks level funded. We're not saying that we expect no raises to go to that person or those people. We're saying we didn't know yet, so once the contract is settled, we'll transfer money into that from another line, and I'll bring that to your attention as we go.
Where are you putting that money?
I'll tell you. Yep, mm-hmm. Almost there. Your teacher's salary, this is level staffing. We're not looking for any new positions or eliminating any positions, and looking again at enrollment and class sizes. We're mm-hmm. looking to hold what we've got right now. So that's what's there for teacher salaries, is level staffing and mm-hmm. meeting the contractual obligations. Mm-hmm. When I look at the next blip, so line 215 has a whole lot going on. One, that is where we put the pool of negotiation dollars. But the pool is not $23,000, because in addition to that, there is an aid that was formally funded from the preschool revolving fund based on preschool tuitions, and that fund, we cannot legally run a revolving fund in the hole. And when looking at the last couple of years and the actual tuitions that came in, it was not enough to cover the aid. So a piece of the aid was added to this line, because it is our obligation, if we don't have other funding mechanism, to make sure we fund that program. So that increase is partly the negotiation pool, and about 0.5 of a preschool assistant. What else is happening there, Kathleen? And we've got a little kind of switch going on with your speech therapist. Is that a change in staff this year?
It is a change in staff. Yep.
That's what it is.
New staff.
Yeah. But unfortunately, on the other end, the contracted services, outside contracted services, are occupational therapy, physical therapy, music therapy.
Right.
I don't know that you have any, but some schools have consulting needs from the teacher of the deaf or teacher of the blind.
We do not have that.
So that's not, and those are based on current year students and current year services being received. Mm-hmm. They're slightly increased over past years, and the cost next year is anticipated to increase.
Right.
So that's what's happening in that line there, with a little bit of a bump up. Any other questions on that page? I have moved to three, and I do not see a ton going on with the exception all the way down of guidance, which again is staff turnover.
It is.
After we built last year's budget and filled the position. So current year budget actually, I believe, has a surplus on it because the replacement, we did not know we were getting that turnover. And when we replaced it, replaced it as lower dollars. I had something and I have forgotten. The only note of interest is that textbook line has stayed consistent for the number of years, and it has not been increased for Go Math. We implemented 2 years ago now, or last year.
This is year three.
A new math series, school-wide, actually, Union 61-wide, and we've, again, fortunately, used school choice dollars to pay for the materials and the manipulatives and teacher sets. It actually was a 3-year payment plan for 6 years of materials. So again, the third year of that will be paid for by school choice. Then we should have 3 years of no cost at all. Then we've got to be prepared in year seven to have a little bit of a spike back, and we'll have to talk about where that goes which is really where it should be. But the cost won't be the same as the last 3 years because those initial teacher sets and startup kits won't be needed. It'll just be the ongoing manipulatives and materials for the students.
Right.
It's just worth noting that the budget did not need to pay for that new math series. There's probably new science curriculum and materials coming down the road, though, so
it
we
is,
should be
and
ready.
That's not in there.
No.
That's not
because we
in
don't
there.
Know for sure what it is, but it'll be a fiscal 18 issue, I believe. Mm-hmm. Anything else on page 3? Legally, from general funds, no. Your legal requirement for your general fund is it's got to be spent by June 30th. You can encumber something that you've already ordered and even like received but haven't gotten the invoice yet. Or sometimes if it's a project in process and the work has begun, you could encumber the cost of that, as you should have already before you did the cost anyway, and encumber that and pay it as soon as it's done in July or so. But you can't legally earmark funds.
What has been the historic cost per year for that, you know, split in free payment?
For the math,
I think it was 69.
I have 9,500. I think on that.
Oh, it was 69 when we were paying over the 6 years.
Right, and then it bumped. Yeah, it ended up being a 3-year. It's got a better, but
which was
so
it
was 9,500 for
3 years.
I couldn't even guess what science will look like, but it's not huge. Yeah. You know, in a small school. And as long as you can do it over 3 years, which most companies out there want to work with you, they know it's much harder to take a $30,000, $40,000 bite than to do it over a number of years.
What, now, that would come out of school choice, you're anticipating?
I can't predict science. That's what we're able to do for math.
Right. What you're planning on starting with science?
Well, the science, the state is still firming up the revised curriculum. So
they're now making those decisions.
Yeah.
They're pretty set, but it'll be a while before they get it to us in black and white saying, okay, here it is, this is what you need to utilize. So I think you're right.
It's 18 at the earliest. It's not going to happen during 17. If best case scenario is fiscal 17 is used to do the exploring and to do the piloting and figure out what materials are best, and we try to do that Union 61 wide and have all elementary schools work together to come up with agreement. But that's probably fast paced. Maybe fiscal 18 is a piloting year.
Could be that.
And
too.
19 is actually when we're purchasing items. So
is what you're saying that if you don't know if the science curriculum would be able to be entered into an agreement like that?
We don't know yet what materials or books or what it's going to look like.
I'm not even so much concerned. We know something's coming.
Yes, absolutely.
I'm just asking about the form of finance.
The only thing I can say is that historically, book companies definitely have those types of agreements and want to work into a multi-year agreement because they know schools can't afford to do it all at once. Because the alternative is to implement it, which has also been done in my tenure, by grade.
Second and third.
In year one, you're only doing K through one, and then 2, 3, so it's rolling up with those kids, but the upper level kids never get the new materials. So that is an option. But in the last few years, we have seen most companies are looking to enter into multi-year deals as opposed to
For publishing companies.
It's their bread and butter. They're going to work with you.
Makes a lot more sense for them to do a full run and sell it all.
What I can't guess is...
Have it sitting on their shelves.
What I can't guess is what the cost will be. I wouldn't even venture to say that it's the same as math. You know, science is different than math, and we'll see what happens.
But what we can say is that going into 2018, we're going to see a drop-off because that three-year contract, or at least that those three-year payments will be up. So what we've been funding out of school choice, we're going to have a little bit of a
In the school choice, yes. For the last 3 years, there's a line that's been held there in school choice. So in theory, that would free up a few dollars.
Freeze up a little bit. So we'll have a cushion,
is what I'm saying. That's a place that can legally actually be squirreling away money for in anticipation.
What is the balance right now in school choice?
Oh, jeez. So let me take a look at what we did last week, 293. I believe it's about 300, 350.
There's a bunch
given what we voted
to.
What hasn't been spent yet this year, I believe would be probably about $300,000, $350,000 at year end. Before we spend all of next year's.
Right.
Yep. Which we voted some of.
Yeah, which we will vote tonight.
Yep. And you did vote your capital plan.
Yes.
Okay, I am on page 4. And the only note that I see worth saying is we did go down in special ed transportation directly connected to the decreasing cost of gas, which makes me a little nervous because for some reason in the past week,
it's summer.
I know, you're right. Yeah. So, I mean, we certainly looked at last year's expenditures and looked what's been happening with gas because that is the special ed fleet that we do manage in-house. So as the cost goes down, we have a savings. The regular ed transportation will be the second year of a 3-year contract that is level for 3 years, regardless of whether the gas spikes up or down.
Right.
But level is good.
It is very good.
Yeah. Yeah.
What services does the school physician provide?
They write us scripts for our EpiPens. It's mostly a signature. They have to provide a signature on some of our health care plans. So it's really documentation.
An occasional I know some of the nurses occasionally
rarely do
will
we
call
need
and
a
do
consultant,
a
but it's mostly signature documentation kinds of stuff to let us do the things that we need that we have to have a doctor's, a physician's permission to do.
Okay. I am now on page 5. And again, you see that first line with the custodian salary that's looks level and ultimately might be a little bit higher while the assistant line earlier in the budget decreases when we finish negotiating. We were able to reduce the fuel cost, knowing that we've already locked into oil.
Right.
We've been using propane here for the last couple of years, and we'll continue to use gas rates kind of follow the same flow oil does, which has typically been lower than oil. But as oil has gone down, gas has gone down too. We have the ability at any point in time in this building to flip the switch and go to the other. So we watch both.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Electricity, however, we do continue to struggle with. So the number there is strictly looking at what last year's expenditures were. We try to be as efficient as possible. And I know we've got, you know, some solar net metering agreements out there with the town, but we've got to be realistic, and for the last couple of years we've been a little bit higher, so that's what we built and budgeted, and some of it may very well be the increased technology in the building. You've got, you know, many more devices mm-hmm. that you're using mm-hmm. and charging, but we did have to increase that to be realistic.
How is it trending this year?
I'm not quite sure because we're a bit behind in getting the bills. Okay. anything else on that page? Moving to six. And that is simply your copier?
It is,
yep.
Yeah, the replacement.
Oh, just one other point on the electric,
yep.
Just as an FYI.
Mm-hmm.
I know that National Grid had a disconnect for like 2 or 3 months recently from our net metering.
Okay.
So if you haven't seen any credits lately, I got their new analyst in touch with the solar.
Okay. All right.
I got this panic email saying, can you give us the, you know, hour by hour data? And I'm like, nope, I can't, but I know a guy that can.
Yeah, awesome.
So,
awesome.
So you should.
That's helpful.
Okay. You know, I think that, yeah, because the credits we usually see, and I will have to check. Last I checked, you know, a month or two ago, we were very far behind in getting the, is it Washington National?
Washington Electric and Gas.
That's it. Those, because I think they come to the town as a whole, and then we get the school's share?
No, the group, I don't know.
Okay. We were behind in that.
Yeah.
I think we are at least a month or two behind. Right now, we're kind of middle of the road. We had 22,000 of the 45 spent, but I believe that's probably about a half a year's, which could put us right on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Seems about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Again, page six is simply the copier is leased 3 years.
There's two copiers.
Two copiers, 3 year leases,
mm-hmm.
And one. Is it one or both of them that are up that we entered into a newer?
Went up.
One of them had a higher cost of lease.
Right.
That's all that line is the copiers, building copiers. Okay. Page seven is, I call that the good news, but I literally have on my notes, dot, dot, dot.
Cautious.
So the good news is it is a significant projected savings based on current students, where they are, and where they'll be next year.
Mm-hmm.
And there's been a decrease. I believe there's at least one student that was brought back in-house to a secondary program. We do have the in-house programs, and we try our best to keep them in-house. So the good news is looking at there's very little left there. The bad news is there's very little left there. That's really, and one of those also shows is net the circuit breaker state reimbursement, which will start declining too. So you've really only, by the looks of it, got two students getting out of district place services and out of district placement. My concern is just when you get down that low, one placement is the low end placements these days are between $40,000 and $50,000, and the worst case for residentials are $150,000 to $200,000. So I worry about if that were to happen in the middle of a year, we have the obligation to deal with it. Now, the middle of the year would be as if one of our current Brookfield students who are in one of our three buildings, and this is not just elementary, this is the line where we deal with all Brookfield K through age 22, or 2.9 through 22.
Right.
But, you know, if, and right now everybody's stable, I think we're doing great and everybody's in good shape, but if something happened and one student was all of a sudden not able to be served appropriately in one of our three and resulted during the year in an out-of-district placement, it is this budget's obligation to fund it. I'm not as concerned with move-ins, but if someone moved in from Massachusetts, from someplace else in Massachusetts to Brookfield and had a child placed at one of these placements, if it happens after April 1st, 2 weeks from now, April 1st, we don't have to pay for it out of this budget. The community they move from would have to pay for it, and that's a kind of common courtesy. It's implied it's already been budgeted. Let them pay for it year one, and we would have to build it year two.
Yep.
The only problems are if someone from out of state moves in with some major placement then. So it's awesome. We only budget what we know of. We never budget, you know, maybes, anticipateds. But it's just my kind of warning. Things are very calm and quiet here in Brookfield, and I hope they stay that way. But this is the line that can just blow out very quickly. And then we have one vocational application for a program that Tantascwa does not offer. So you have the legal obligation to fund that. Technically, the deadline for that is also April 2nd. We could get another last minute request and have to deal with it, but we're budgeting what we know. Actually, Brookfield's, it's probably Pathfinder. I don't know offhand, but it's probably Pathfinder. Sometimes we get Brookfield applications to BayPath, but BayPath has been full for years and can't serve their own member towns, so they very rarely take a non-member person. So it's probably Pathfinder. And
do you know what the vocation is?
I don't know for sure, but I could bet it's either cosmetology or
auto.
Yeah. Those are the two.
And are there any plans for us to?
There are not. There are not. Automotive, we
that
don't have the space, and it's far too expensive. And right now, we really don't have the space even to bring on another cosmetology, especially when between my five towns in any given year, there are probably only two, three tops students going outside of Tantascwa for vocational, so we can't really justify it.
Right. We couldn't fill the program if we had it.
Yep. So that brings us to the school committee has, I think, graciously agreed to continue to put another $200,000 of school choice funds toward the budget to be able to decrease the request going to the town, which would be that 1.4% increase. And I had a comfort level making that recommendation, knowing that we're a very sought-after school district, and your interest, and I don't know offhand how many kindergarten school choice applications, 13. So, and we won't decide how many school choice kindergartners we can take until June, when we feel like we have a better handle on what the Brookfield kindergarten resident population is. But you definitely have a very appealing school district, and the interest from school choice continues to be there. So knowing that that looks like a pretty steady stream at this point in time, we felt comfortable putting the 200 again towards operations.
Yeah, it kind of is a self-fulfilling prophecy, because we're getting so much school choice that we're putting so much into the capital plan to make the school put in a position where you are bringing in these students.
Yeah.
So it's putting us in a good position.
Yeah.
Is that increase, though, causing us to have to, I'm just wondering if, I think it's 57 school choice students right now, and each one of those, yes, we do get the money from the various towns and into that fund, but have you calculated out what the cost is actually? I'm guessing you're not hiring new teachers because
Correct.
But then there is the cost for technology, so that's becoming, that's kind of expensive.
It's nowhere close to, as long as we are not looking at adding classrooms, which we are not, and the Brookfield population is of that size that you want a few extra to make two nice. It's too much to have one classroom.
We would have classrooms of 29.
And then you split it and you get classrooms of 13, which is really actually too small. So we're in that good place. So as long as we're not looking at needing to create more classrooms, you're talking about the basic. It doesn't cost you more to heat. It doesn't cost you more to turn the lights on. It's a little bit of technology, which school choice is paying for anyway, and basic materials. It's not even close to the 5,000, so it's still. And remember, any school choice student receiving special needs services, those are calculated for, and you get additional dollars for those services.
And we're looking at class sizes of 21, in some cases 22. Our computer labs, each one house 25 computers. So there's no impact to Brookfield students, which is really the critical thing that we want to keep our eyes on.
Right, that's the priority.
Yeah. It allows us to optimize the staff. At the same time, we can spread out the fixed cost.
Right. So the cost per student is $10,000
to educate a student? It's somewhere there. I don't have it. There is by school district. So I would say $9,000 to $10,000 is the average, but I don't think I have that printed out. It'd be one of the things I don't.
We get that back.
We do not get that in school choice. We only get five for each school choice child. We only get $5,000 per child. Yeah. Unless they're on an IEP, then it depends on what their needs are.
It's more if we have.
But if you weren't taking school choice students, for instance, say we had none, our cost per
be a...
It would.
Yes.
Organic Brookfield students.
Right.
Taking both the child and the fund.
Right.
Yep.
Lowers our per head count cost.
Yep.
Some monies in to help support the infrastructure.
Yep.
Absolutely, we'd have to remove that $200,000 from the budget, which would absolutely mean a number of positions cut.
Yeah.
A number of classrooms at 37.
Yeah.
30, or 27, 28.
In addition to that, also the capital plan.
Right.
So it's not just the capital budget you're talking about.
I mean, that's the bigger nut, is that this regular operating budget, we've not asked the town for capital items, project work, and technology, which technology is the same as paper and pencil these days. You have to every year plan on keeping up your computers, and we're moving into a wireless world, but the computers are a necessity. They're not a luxury anymore. They're required. So they, in if we did not have school choice, and in other districts, it's got to be a every year there's got to be a hardware component to the budget. But
yeah, I'll get on my soapbox for a minute and just say that, you know, what the school choice has allowed us to do, and it's only because of the staff at this whole organization, from the teachers, the principal, superintendent, the work they've done to make this school, put it in the position it's in, so that we can get the school choice, allows us to have a gem here in the town.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, we can be fiscally responsible.
Because
1.4% is not a strong increase.
Yep.
And you look at it over the last 7 years, and the highest was 3.5, and that was an anomaly. The other ones are, sometimes you're below, sometimes you're just barely above. So yeah, it's a testament to the great job that the administration's doing, but it allows us to do a lot of things.
Absolutely.
That's true.
Yep.
That's true.
Yep, absolutely.
If I could just backtrack for one second.
Mm-hmm.
Just something that occurred to me. The library, what is the situation with the librarian right now? I know at one time it was kind of part-time-ish almost.
Oh, no.
Somebody
filled in. No.
Way back.
Oh, yeah, no. Yeah, no. We've had for a number of years.
Since I've been here. This is my 11th year. We've had...
Well,
it's not a full-time position. It's a 0.5 position, because a 0.5 position sees every child from kindergarten to grade 6 every week. And they share the job. We're fortunate enough to have someone who has technology degree and a library degree. So the other half of her job is to do computer classes every week for every child kindergarten to grade 6. So all of our specialists, we only need them 0.5 a week, to like our art teacher, in order to see every child. And that's what we consider a full-time position, because every kid gets serviced. That's what we go by.
But I do remember, Marie, and then it was quite some years ago, that it was probably pre-you, Kathleen.
It was.
That
it was
part-time, and it was volunteer,
kind of.
And it's been, the person that is currently doing the dual job has been here 8, 10 years?
Eight.
So
I had someone else the first.
No, that's probably just for the half.
That's a half.
Yeah, it's a very seasoned person.
Yeah.
Yep.
And then separately, you have a technology person.
That's the same person.
Same person.
Same person does both those jobs.
Someone that's...
Oh, the maintenance, the technology maintenance is, you know what? Here's my warning.
Yeah.
We have two folks that take care of 5 buildings, the 4 smaller elementary schools and junior high. They're awesome. The technology guys, and they help out at the town hall.
Mm-hmm.
So actually, and they're Brookfield boys. they are awesome. We run them ragged, but they do a great job. I think they kind of like that variety, and they're all over the place. But as we put more devices and more technology into the schools, fiscal 18 at least, we're going to need to be having that conversation, that that probably will need to be upped to some extent. What it is, we don't know yet, and what the interest, but we have had conversations about, as we move
mm-hmm.
more to one-to-one device type area, you put more devices in, you have more technology used on a regular basis, the needs are going to increase significantly. And I don't think for more than another year that we can get away with for the 2 people supporting what they do now, and 4 town halls that they support also. So
coming in, does that decrease the hard copy
It has. Oh, the textbooks across the district have decreased significantly over the years.
I guess, and that's, I suppose that's natural, that's yep. going to happen. I'm yep. just not comfortable with it because the kids can't take home the devices, so the parents don't have access to the curriculum.
And that's another, that I mean, over the next couple of years, we've really got to look at if and when we want to move into kind of a one-to-one device scenario. At the elementary level, you're correct, I don't think we'd ever be at a place where we want kids to bring it home. So curriculum has to be devised that. Mm-hmm. But we're also doing surveys, and you would be quite surprised how many, I mean, it's a 99% of students have devices and computers at home, but we've still got to, we're not putting devices in classrooms just for the sake of putting devices in classroom.
But I think Marie's point actually, is there an opportunity to provide login access to mm-hmm. parents that want to be involved in the curriculum?
Already go
back. Oh yeah, that already.
Okay.
Already.
So that information is available to them if they want to review mm-hmm. the kids' curriculum, they can.
Yeah.
So I just worry about the ones that don't
have. Right, and well, and we have a lot an obligation to make sure that we're giving equal access in one way or another, and that's what we've got to work through. Yep.
Yeah. And there still is lots of hard copy stuff. Math still, even though they're textbooks, they have their student workbooks that they do take home with them to complete homework assignments.
To that point,
when they're doing literacy, they have their novels that are still paper novels that they take home for their reading assignments. So yes, we are still having things go back and forth to home so parents have in their hands things that students are learning. We do have social studies textbooks. We don't send those home as regularly just because of the big math book. You put the big science book, you put the big social studies book, and you got a fifth grader with 42 pounds on their back. It doesn't even make sense when they can take home a packet of information from that chapter that keeps them from having to do that. And it's more organized for them. They don't lose as much when it's that way.
And in addition to that, I just want to say that we funded mm-hmm. over the last 5 years $10,000 to the library to buy new books every year. So we have that in the budget for 2017, and then we also have it for 2018, the capital plan.
I would certainly venture to say that while textbook lines decrease a little bit and technology increases, so does the copy paper use and the printer wear and tear.
It does. It does.
I've just always been one to like to have
Yep. If there are no other questions, the chair would end the public hearing and move back into regular session.
Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. Well, yes.
I don't have a clean copy, but I could get it to you tomorrow. I don't know if anyone has clean copies, but they have reviewed and voted on it.
Very dirty copy. Very dirty copy.
I'd be happy to send you a copy tomorrow.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, we're going to move back into normal regular session.
And the only order of business left would be to vote the budget that you would like to move to town meeting with, which I recommend for fiscal 17 would be $2,957,688.
Yep. So I'll make a motion to bring forward a budget of $2,957,688 to the town meeting on behalf of the Brookfield Elementary School budget.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. It is passed.
Awesome.
Brought forward.
I had nothing else this evening.
Okay. With that, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We are adjourned. Thank you, everybody, for coming.